But I want to ask you a simple question. The question is there. Are you a leader? Are you a leader? If you think you are a leader, raise your hand. Thank you very much. Of course, I am talking to a very elite audience, right? So the answer was expected. But you will be surprised. When I ask the same question, are you a leader? In many companies or in many forums, I hardly have few hands going up. Because they are always looking at the CEO or the MD or their boss, you know, the super boss sitting there. You know, he is a leader, I am not, you know. So, how can I put up my hand as a leader? They don't even accept the fact that they are leaders. That will tell you, when you talk about, look at the way another person is thinking about oneself. He is not even confident to proclaim to the world, yes, I am a leader. So you're talking about provoking the leadership mindset. Look at the difference. Yeah? So being a leader, very important sentence, very important word. Being a leader doesn't require a title. You don't need a designation. You don't need somebody to call you that you are so-and-so manager. You don't need that at all. You don't need a title. Because that's why sometimes a clerical staff can be a very good leader. I look at the way he takes leadership. He takes, no problem, sir. I will get it done. He'll push. So leadership can come at all levels. It depends on your mind. So that's why having a title doesn't make you one. And you have seen, a lot of managers have titles, but do they behave like leaders? They don't. Sir, can you sign this? No, let him come back tomorrow. He'll come and shout at me. I don't want to sign. It's okay. No, sir, you are the authority, you are the person, you can sign, you can sanction. No. What is he? Afraid to take a risk? Afraid that somebody can pin him down tomorrow? Height of insecurity? Height of inferiority complex for a senior manager? How many you see that? I'm sure you would have noticed many such people who carry titles as managers, but who don't live up to that title. And that is where, when you say, I want to provoke my leadership mindset, my leadership thinking, yes, you have to do a difference, you have to do something. So, when you talk about leadership, very important, we talk about the pandemic impact, we talk about the globalization which is happening at the same time. You notice the pandemic has made a complete global supply chain difference. Huge shifts are happening. Huge shifts. Right? Because China was still recently the back end. It's the factory for the world. So a lot of supplies went, even now, a lot of automotive companies are struggling for the simple reason it's not coming from China. Right? They're talking about semiconductor chips for the mobiles. It has to come from Taiwan and China. Not there. We can make the mobile, but then there's no chip for you. Right? And that's why the Tatas are jumping in now with the 5,000 crore project in Tamil Nadu. Right? And probably likely to extend to 8,000 crores. So lots of things are happening which never happened all these years, including the pharma world. Correct? The amount of things that are happening out of India today, right? A lot of generics were coming from, imported from China. But then now there's a big shift in India itself, and that's a big plus point. Right? India is going to be leading the world very soon, right? Competing. And that way, one of the best things that is happening the world over, of course, technology is changing so rapidly. Everything is changing. You know, as we are talking, there are technological advancements. So gone are the days you can say that I've done my M.Tech, I've done my BE, this is the technology I knew 20 years back, and the same thing will take me through. No. Because what you knew yesterday is irrelevant today. That means the shelf life of knowledge. We said knowledge is power, right? That's a very famous quote. But today, the shelf life of knowledge is almost zero. What I knew yesterday is irrelevant today. So if I don't keep in pace, if I don't change with the times, I'm stuck. And of course, the demographics. Huge shifts. You see every day. Every day, the The power play in the world is changing. Middle East is in hell. Very soon all your petrol and diesel are going to go out. Right? And it's all electric and probably other alternate sources of energy. So that means the way we live, your entire world, the way transportation is looked at, your mobiles are looked at, everything is changing. Everything. We never thought what has happened. We have already experienced the change. And that is going to continue even more rapidly. And that's a cause for worry, and that's a cause for happiness. Because a lot of good things are going to happen. So if you know how to catch the right thing, you will catch the happiness part. If you don't know, then you're left behind. So you talk about those who fail to anticipate what the organization and the employee should be doing to survive and thrive in the face of the pandemic impact. The globalization, technology and demographic changes will lose control of the future. So that is why today's topic is very relevant and very important to each and every one of us here, not just in this room, everyone out there. Because if you are not getting ready for the future, you are going to be finished. Right? Because these forces, they will surrender their fate to the tornado and eventually be left behind. So you and me today have no choice at all. Harold Janine says, leadership is practiced not so much in words as in attitude and in action. So when we talk about provoking leadership mindset, what is the attitude you're bringing? An attitude of I can or attitude of I can't? Let me see. Let me postpone it tomorrow. Let me see. Then you're finished. If there's a Chinese proverb, when the winds of change blow, some people build walls. You notice that in organizations. And others build windmills. So ask yourself, what are you doing? Are you building a wall? Or are you building a windmill? Are you making most out of the situation? Or are you succumbing and becoming a victim of the situation? Right? What's going to happen? So the force of change to the pandemic and your organization. The challenge today had sent shockwaves through industries and economies. The world is shaken up. You know, you stay on the news. The world's response to the situation has resulted in the most rapid transformation of our workplace. In the way we train is completely changed in the last couple of months. And the greatest impact has been the human one, a totally new routine, working from home, dealing with fear and dealing with uncertainty. Nobody knows what's going to happen tomorrow. So what am I going to do? How am I going to deal with? There is a whole lot of uncertainty. And you know millions of jobs are lost. So many people without jobs. And there is no hope that they will get something. Because what they knew yesterday is irrelevant today. They are not even ready for the purpose. So what are you going to do? Jack Dixon says, if you focus on results, you will never change. If you focus on change, you will get results. So our focus is on change. It is not on results. And the famous words of Jack Dixon. Can you tell me where is it derived from? Anybody can tell me the source? Absolutely, sir. Thank you. Bhagavad Gita. Right? Karma Jnana Adhikaras. Right? So you don't look for result. You do what you think you need to do. Right? If the change is the order of the day, you do it. The new normal. We have gone from digitizing the relationship between organization and the customer to digitizing the relationship between employer and the employee. Huge change. And that is why for HR practitioners, HR professionals like you, it becomes very important because it's the employer employee. The people dynamics, right? The internal customer becomes so much more important. we have been catapulted forward, fast-tracking trends such as automation, digitization, and limitless innovation. Look at the amount of innovation that is happening all around us. Blueprint. You heard about the blueprint and life under construction. But the thing is, there is no blueprint for what we are facing today. And the business leaders around the world are changing strategies to keep up because pandemic has happened first time. Of this magnitude, the whole world has kind of shrunk and collapsed. There is no past experience of this magnitude. So where is the blueprint? What example will you draw from? Oh, last time we have done it like this, maybe that will work. There is nothing. First time we are going through. So leaders have no chance but to innovate, to keep changing. Okay, this the plan A didn't work, sort of. Go to plan B. That didn't work, okay, look at something else. That didn't work, look at that. They said English has how many alphabets? 26. I imagine that you arrive at Z, then what do you do? A1, A2, A3. Right? So you will get it absolutely endless. So the moment you have a flexible mindset to deal with this pandemic era, you are a different metal altogether. You are a different being altogether. So this pandemic is also a catalyst, henceforth, to reinvent the future of work for anyone who take the opportunity to make things better than they were. To make things better. It's a wonderful opportunity for us. So let's look at it from a very, very positive angle. Those that capitalize on the post-pandemic opportunities will find themselves in a good position to retain their talent and attract people when the situation stabilizes. Look at the beauty here. Look at the, have you been noticing the share market? It's jumping. It is running wild. You have never seen it like that. Right? So a lot of people who regularly invest in stock, they're saying, oh, they're having a killing. Right? They're minting money. It's just jumping, leapfrogging. So, pandemic era, post-pandemic era, people are making money. Are you? Hands up. If you are not, it's time to change. People have made millions, people have made billions. There is no reason any one of us should get left behind just under the fear of pandemic. No. You are bold, you are brave, you are not risk averse, then opportunities are there for you. Right? So, by contrast, those that fail to change will be left behind, exposing their employees to increased risk of financial distress, facing layoffs and closure. That is a sad thing. Sad thing where the leaders don't know how to deal with the situation. So they look at the easy option out. Layoffs, closing plants, shutting down product lines, right? Shutting off markets.
What are you doing? Why don't you innovate? Why don't you look at, why are you looking back at the old ways that you have done all these years that helped you, but not anymore? Can you change? And that becomes important. You will need to have new mindsets, new behaviors, and values to benefit in the fast-changing workplace. What do you see there? Red is standing out. Wonderful. Yeah. Right. The secret of successfully dealing with sudden change in life lies in seeing life differently. And that's where the provocation happens in the leadership mindset, in its different shades and its different outcomes. So no one gets ahead by copying the status quo or by just imitating competitors. So it's not about copying, you know, okay, we are done like this, the same thing will carry us through. No, it is not going to happen. And if you're going to copy just because the competitor did that, chances are that you may end up not so successful or probably struggling. It is not about copying anymore. Yeah. The concept of being unique or different is far more important in today's changing world. The question to you is, how are you different? How are you value adding to yourself? How are you value adding to your team, your department, your organization? In your own community, in your neighborhood, in your own family, how are you value adding? Is there too much of negative talk within your family or in your department, in your team? Are you waiting? Oh, I don't know what will happen. I don't know what the management will do. I don't know what the CEO is thinking, right? If that kind of a negativity has crept in and you have thrown up your hand and you're feeling helpless, then there is the challenge. If you are going to face the onslaught of relentless and constantly growing global change, you need to be different and radically change the way of thinking, the way of feeling, and the way of doing business. Everything has to change. The way you think, the way you feel, your emotions. Yes, there are a lot of things emotionally you are committed to, right? You have done it like that, but then life is different now. Five phases of organizational change. Adaptability and crisis. Have you read about Ellie Graner? If you're not read, very, very briefly, wonderful character. He says, stage of change and adaptability on one side, and then others, you know, you have the x-axis as time. If you look at it, when an organization starts, we have a lot of startup companies which are starting now. You know, incidentally, India is a hub of a lot of startups, and Bangalore also is leading. A lot of startups are happening now. It's a creativity phase. You're establishing a new organization, right? And the moment you do that, there is always a crisis of leadership. Who is going to lead? Because who is a startup guy? He's got no experience in business. He's new, right? He may be intelligent. He may be academically qualified. He may even have work experience, like many of us quit jobs to start up a company. But you have never led a business, right? Being a head of the department in one aspect of the company and tomorrow becoming an entrepreneur is totally different cup of tea, right? HR professional wanting to become an entrepreneur. A salesman wanting to become an entrepreneur. Salesman know how to sell, but he does not know finance. He does not know legal. He does not know companies, you know, laws and processes. He does not know HR. He does not know R&D. He does not know technology. He does not know operation. There are so many areas. You take a production guy becoming an entrepreneur, he does not know other things. So this, or a finance guy becoming, he does not know marketing. He does not know HR. He does not know something else. So nobody is holistic. And that's where the challenge is. Yeah. So there is a crisis of leadership. Now, when you, let's imagine that you have successfully overcome that phase, right, in your leadership phase, you go to the direction phase. In the direction phase, you have a crisis of autonomy, independence. Correct? Leave me alone. No, let me do it. Why are you interfering with me every day? Correct? You talk about centralized leadership. You're talking about decentralized leadership. Companies, family-run companies are victims of highly centralized command and control kind of a leadership. That's why they also struggle unless they corporatize the entire dimension. So you have the delegation phase where there is crisis of control. I'm delegated, but now I don't know how to control. I'm not getting updates. I don't know what is happening in your department. I don't know what's happening in that region. I don't know what is happening in that unit. Right? So there is that phase. Now you have coordination phase. Okay, now you talk about a lot of teamwork, team building, collaboration, etc., etc., etc. Crisis of red tape. And you look at the next one. Collaboration phase leads to crisis of uncertainty. Now you tell me, now you notice, you look at all the companies in the world. Small and medium enterprises, medium to large enterprises, and of course, huge giants. Can you look at, they're all there somewhere. So that means there is no single company in the world which doesn't have a problem. So when you talk about provoking the leadership mindset, it really doesn't matter whether you're working for a small enterprise or a large enterprise or a very large enterprise. Problems are there, And that is why today, for you and me, it becomes imperative, it becomes important that we take this challenge head on. There is no company without a problem. And to tell you the truth, there is no family without a problem. Agreed, sir? Kannadalundi, adhe ide. Ellar maneyallo dosa thootundi. Correct? So it is the same story that applies. Right? So you look at it, the languages may change, but then the meaning, the context is that there is no house without a problem, there is no organization without a problem, there is no department without a problem, there is no team without a problem. Correct? Indian cricket team had a lot of problems in the first test just now. Not that the problems are over, they've just leveled it. Anyway, so that's the dimension. So are you, the question to each one of you here, are you prepared to face the race? How ready are you? How equipped are you? Right? So where do you stand with respect to global standards? If you want to set your company apart, if you want to set your own career apart, when it comes to global standards, where are you? Very big question. These are questions to help you introspect, to help you reflect. Yeah? Then, is there a gap between business expectations and the skills you possess? Is there a skill gap? Yeah, you have tremendous potential. But between what you are capable of and what you are currently performing, is there a gap? And if there is a gap, how are you going to fill it? Right? How are you going to bridge the gap? If you don't bridge the gap, there will be a gap in your career. If you can't bridge the gap, there will be a gap in your business, in your performance. Right? So don't expect promotions when you don't bridge the gap. Right? People can be nice to you. So that's why I always say, I know here is a team of HR professionals, but I say that openly in companies and I have some very pathetic looks. I always ask them, do you know what is the meaning of the designation senior manager? A lot of companies have that designation, senior manager. Senior manager is poor guy. He's worked for 10 years, 15 years, right? Promotion nahi mila, nobody gave him a promotion. And the youngsters are going ahead, they are getting promoted, they are moving ahead. But he's a nice guy. Committed, loyal, very good guy. So somebody comes to you, right? You know, head of the department, somebody, you know, Basavaraj, can you do something? Right? Can we promote him? Okay, now you also wonder, right? There's nothing to promote, right? So there's nothing to promote him because he's going to be doing the same job. Tomorrow nothing is going to change. It's the same role, same responsibility. But you need to give him a promotion. So it is called a sympathy promotion. Senior manager. Senior manager, maybe give him some 2-3 increments and make it. So a lot of senior managers. Same job, same role. So now, if you are a senior manager, or if you have too many senior managers in your company, something is not okay, no? Seriously not okay. So that means, you have hit a board there already, you know, the hierarchy ceiling has come. We are dealing, the company is dealing with a bunch of incompetent managers. That's why we say, lots of managers, very few leaders. Because manager is a title given by somebody. Right? You type it out in a letter and give it to him as an offer. But leadership, you don't need a title. So that is why when we say provoking the leadership mindset, each one of you, I see some very experienced stalwarts here and I also see a lot of youngsters here. Right? Who have a wonderful years ahead of them to make a rosy career, then I'm telling you, don't become a senior manager. If it comes, take it. But don't yearn for that. Let's look at something beyond. That's why it's very important for us to look at how would you bridge the gap. So, what is the difference between the best and the rest? It's very important for us to understand that there are many people who know their job very well, who know how to deal with people, who know how to communicate their ideas, but when one needs to stand out from the rest and excel in their field, what happens? Good is not good enough. You're good, but you're not good enough. So now this is the challenge, right, in the post-pandemic era. When you say provoking the leadership mindset, you are good, you are damn good, but you are not good enough. So then what are you going to do? I'm telling you, it is a big challenge. It is a big challenge for organizations today. And I'll tell you very soon, why is it a big challenge for you and me, right? The big challenge is because what does research say? Research says that the top performers in this world are only 3% and the 10% are good performers. So that makes it how much? 13% only. 60% are average performers and 27% are poor performers. So you have a top doctor, a good doctor, an average doctor and a poor doctor. A top architect to a poor architect. A top electrician to a poor electrician. A top gardener or a plumber or an electrician to a poor performer. You name any profession, be it a receptionist or your housemaid. There's a top, good, average, poor. Yes, no? And look at the statistics, right? One way of looking at that is when you add 60 plus 27, it gives you 87% of the world's population are average and below, poor performers. So when you conduct interviews, 87% of the candidates who come from in front of you are all average fellows. How are you going to choose the best? It's not easy. That's why your challenge of recruitment itself is tough. Because you are filtering out 87% to look for that 3%, 10%. Not easy to come by. Big, big challenge. Yep. And yet another way, these 87% will never become the minority. That's why you talk about minority. What do? The researchers went in, they found out that they think and feel different. This is where you like the dialogue. I'll say the dialogue. The dialogue is in Hindi. Hindi malum hai na sabko? Huh? Soch badlo. Soch badlo, desh badlega. But I am telling you, soch badlo, aapka life badlega, aapka career badlega. Aapka jeevan badlega. Right? You want to change your life. You want to change your thinking. You want to change your way you're looking at. Provoking the mindset, that is why you come back to that thought process. Thinking. Right? And that's what they do. Extra plus ordinary. So what do this minority do? They do ordinary things, whether it is Ratan Tata or Narayan Murthy. They do ordinary Abdul Kalam. Great leaders. Simple guys. They do ordinary things, but they're willing to stretch that little extra. The question is, are you willing to do the little extra? Or are you a clock watcher? 9 to 5 only I do, sir. Oh, Saturday, Sunday, I cannot come. Right? The moment you look at that, right, there is a challenge. Balanced IQ and EQ. IQ is the left brain, EQ is the right brain. You know, companies after companies we go, they tell me one thing. You know, Srinidhi, actually, you know, this training and all, these guys are very good, technically experts, no problem. But, what is the but? So, IQ is not the problem. EQ is the problem. Emotionally, they cannot connect. There are a lot of, you know, interdepartmental rivalries, you know, fights, misgivings, interpersonal challenges, issues. Oh, gosh. And the concept of be, do, have. I want to be. So, minority believe, I want to be the best. To be the best, I must do this, I must do this, I must do this. To do that, I need to have this. Can you give this? Can you give? Dr. Satya, can you sanction this for me? Correct? Why? Dr. Satya will say, sorry, no, not possible, no budget. So then I need to convince him. I need to go the extra mile to convince him. The moment he sees value in the proposition, somehow he will make arrangements. Am I right, Dr. Satya? Right. So it so happens that you need to convince, but the moment you can do that, because you are not going to rest, I want to be the best. To be the best, I need to do this. To do this, I need to have this. You know, that's where the whole dimension is. And believe, Influence brings power. The only thing that you can do as a leader is to influence people. That's why we say, as a leader, your job is not to do the job. Your job is to get the job done. How are you going to get the job done if you cannot influence people? Right? So that means you must be an expert in your communication. If you are not, pick it up. Join Toastmasters. I would always recommend. I picked up a lot from Toastmasters. I was a very strong member of the Tampines Toastmasters Club in Singapore. Oh, it really helped me. And Toastmasters are there all over, and Bangalore has many, many chapters. So I would say any day, welcome. But majority, look at that. What is the problem? Ordinary thinkers, the IQ, EQ is no balance, either extreme IQ or extreme EQ, have hidden skills but do not use. Potential is there in everybody. Right? The watchman outside has a potential to become a chairman or a managing director, but he doesn't believe so. What are you going to do? It is his belief. Have, do, be. Look at that. The entire equation reverse. I don't have it. I cannot speak English like you. I'm not as educated as you are, you know, like you. I don't have a title like you. Because I don't have it, I cannot do it. Because I cannot do it, I will not be the best. That's the majority thinking. So ask yourself, do you want to be in this mindset of have, do, be, or move up here? Believe power brings influence. So you give me the title, sir, then I will do. You give me the designation, sir, then I will do. So they believe only somebody gives a title or a designation, only then they can do. Otherwise, they cannot. Opportunities are there everywhere. The top and the good performers are creating opportunities and grabbing opportunities. Whereas, if you look at the average and the poor performers are waiting, or they are losing opportunities. And that's where the whole majority is. Today, the post-pandemic era, the problem is with the majority. And if you have those majority of those people as your close associates and friends, God cannot help you. Why? Because there's a beautiful proverb in English which says, tell me who your friends are, I will tell you who you are. Because environmental influence, situational influence, they are going to influence. That's why in Sanatana Dharma, they used to say, practice satsang, meet up, look for people who are better than you, right? So that they can stimulate you, they can provoke you. In their company, you will never fail. Because you will be charged, you will be influenced, you will be inspired, you will be motivated, you will be charged up, no issue. Yeah. Look at the pandemic area. There are two things that is happening in the post-pandemic era. One is trust and another one is economy. Right? Economy is either struggling in most countries or it is growing. Like, you know, there are already some good signs are there in some countries. Now trust, either there's trust is very low or the trust is very, very high. Okay? So now the first one, there is uncertainty. See, the economy is growing. There is uncertain, low trust, despite positive growth, aversion to risk, self-doubt, overly careful, protective, operate in comfort zone, maintain status quo, work to plan. That's all. But now if you look at the second one, there is a recession. This is a struggling economy and the trust is also low. Low trust with a struggling economy, hopelessness, fear, pessimism, unrest, negative environment, frustration and anger, which a lot of people are going through right now. And I know you can connect with that. Look at the next one. Improved morale, the trust is improved. Economy is still struggling. Improved morale, recovering economy, high trust, hope for better days. Acche din aane wala hai. Very important to sell hope as leaders. Yeah? Cautious optimism, enhanced efforts, learning to cope, maximizing resources, collaborative approaches, and confident of the future. But you look at the last column, where trust is high and economy is growing. Confident, high trust and growth, optimism, positive environment, growing investments, technological advancements, enhanced digitization, vibrant economy, and hopeful. So if today, when we say provoking the leadership mindset, whether you like it or not, we have to deal with people who are all in different zones. And the majority of them are there. You have to be the guiding light. You have to be the spirit behind in your organization to say that don't worry, things will move for the better. And if you can take that responsibility, you can understand and you can provoke your mindset. Your mindset influences the way you see things that are happening to you and it impacts your actions in response to it. Mindset is influenced by beliefs and what you choose to focus on. It's what is your belief, right? That's where you have a growth mindset and you have a fixed mindset. In a growth mindset, it is all about, let's look at the fixed mindset. Belief, skills are born, you can't learn and grow. And I am either naturally good at something or I am not. But look at, and the focus is performance, outcomes and results, validation, not looking bad. I don't want to look bad in front of my boss. Correct? And I want validation. Sir, is that okay, sir? Sir, if you tell me, I'll go and do it. I need validation. Insecurity. Fixed mindset. But look at the people with a growth mindset. Skills are built, not born. Fantastic. First change. And if I'm good at something, it's because I have built that ability. I can develop new skills and intelligence through effort and perseverance, not giving up. I'll put in effort. I will learn. Yes, I don't know. Let me learn it. Oh, that's a belief. But focus is process of learning and getting better towards excellence. Let's look at the growth mindset. What happens in reality? You have effort, challenges, mistakes, and feedback. Here, sees effort as a path to mastery. Fixed mindset is unable to see the value of putting in time and effort. Upyoga illa, sir. Whatever we do, no point, man. In this company, it's the same thing. You heard this dialogue so many times. Fixed mindset people. Reframes challenges and setbacks as opportunities to grow, whereas perceives challenges as a threat to self-validation and backs out of challenging situations and avoids struggle. And look at, uses mistakes to learn. The growth mindset feels threatened and discouraged by the mistakes. They don't even want to try. They don't want to attempt, and appreciates feedback and uses it and gets defensive, takes it personally, avoids it. Big difference. So ask yourself, what kind of a mindset do you want to grow in yourself? Fixed mindset? You're doomed. Come to the growth mindset. Opens up. Wonderful. The fixed mindset manifests as holding on to the familiar, doing what you know, and keeping your vision narrow to rack up feel-good scores. Whereas on the other hand, growth mindset manifests as a willingness to go through new challenging situations that are outside your comfort zone with a belief that the struggle will teach you useful skills. You have a line of choice, right? Below the line is always a victim's mindset. And you look at it, it is always the past, right? It is not done now. The people with a fixed mindset are always looking at what happened yesterday, what happened 5 years back, what happened last year, that one we could not do, there we failed. So there is no hope at all. They are doomed actually. So they say, wait and see, it's not my job, cover your tail, confusion, tell me what to do, or they ignore, or they deny anything like that happened, or finger pointing, not me, he did that, he did this. These are the people. And they react. There's a beautiful acronym called BED, bet, blame, give excuse, and they're in a state of denial all the time. Yeah, and have to be, we spoke about that. But look at the victor's mindset. They are above the line of choice. There's now, there is future. So when you talk about the post-pandemic era, the leadership provoking the leadership mindset, you're not talking about past. What has happened has happened. Let's change. Let's look at a better ways of doing it. So that's where you're looking at now, because you have to make changes now, today, so that you will have a glorious future. So the victor's mindset is confident, I know what to do. There is compassion, there is continuous growth, and they feel empowered. And the mindset is, what can you do going forward? Proact. What is the problem? Okay, let's see how do we solve it. And look at, they also have an acronym, OAR, the OAR. You know, you need an oar to move your boat ahead. Ownership, accountability, responsibility. They take charge. So ask yourself, do you feel that you have the ownership in your company? Don't limit yourself to HR department, no. Because people resource is across the departments. So tell me which department HR is not there. The moment has HR, if you start looking at routine processes and methodologies, you are gone. Moment you wear a strategic hat, then your influence is across departments. Nothing stops you from going and sitting in any meeting. Because you have a strategic intent in your HR professional mind. And that mindset is very, very critical. So they believe in themselves and therefore feel more powerful than their environment. Learning and growing are more important than being right. They are not threatened by people who are better than them. Look at that. They're not threatened. Oh, you are better than me? Wonderful. Let me learn something from you. You know, that's the kind of a mindset. And the mindset is very clearly, I want to be the best, I want to do, and I want to have. Below the line behavior, right? And of course, we spoke about that. Above the line behavior. Now we look at that, past, now, future. So let's forget it. The pandemic is done, it's damaged. There's no point in going back to history and then struggling with that. Let's look at what change can we bring so that there is a future is better. So the question is, where am I? Where are you today in this mindset? Do you have a victor's mindset or are you playing the victim mindset? And that change is really important because you need to see it, involves recognizing and acknowledging the full reality of a situation. You need to own it, accepting responsibility for the experiences and realities you create for yourself and others, and you need to solve it entails changing reality by finding and implementing solutions, and you need to do it because it entails mustering the commitment and courage to follow through with the solutions you have identified. So you see it, you own it, you solve it, you do it. That means you do everything. From seeing opportunities to owning it, solving it and doing it. That means from start to finish, because results come only when there is action. Karmanyevadhikarasya. Right? If there is no doing, don't expect anything. That's why doing it becomes very, very important. So, what matters most in every organization? So, look at this. There's a native proverb. The proverb says, never follow a leader who is more in love with power than people. So, if you have this command and control kind of a leader, then you have a problem. Because he's not bothered about people. I know this is very pleasing to you because this is a HR forum, right? We believe in people. But unfortunately, not so in many other departments. Correct? So it is on the power rules. So it is where you as a HR professional is going to be playing a very, very influencing role. Right? That is where the pace of change has accelerated dramatically. In recent decades, producing changes in business and society, one consequence of this shift is that people are more important than ever to success. So that is why their importance will only grow in the future. So it's all people, 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 people. So thank God and thank God. You are in the best profession. Human resource. Right? It is not about human resource management, HRM. It is not about HRD, human resource development. It is about HRO, human resource optimization. Because people already have the power. They have the knowledge. All you have to do is provoke it. All you have to do is bring it out of their potential. And I'm telling you, you have the world to offer. There are three strategic challenges that you need to look at. Developing and retaining the best employees. Then, of course, the anticipating the change that you're going through. And the third one is enabling the organization. All the three are very, very critical. Yeah. What is the best way to overcome these challenges? This is the big question all organizations are facing today. And this question was asked in many surveys, many places. And what happened was, this is how the world's best leaders answer. Focus on people's strengths, manage around his or her weaknesses. Gone are the days we are busy looking at people's weaknesses. Oh, you're not good in this, let me train you this. Like, no, don't train people for their weaknesses. Train people for their strengths. That's why we always say Sachin Tendulkar was told, you take tuition in batting, because he was good in batting. His parents did not tell him, you're weak in mathematics, take tuition in mathematics, like the way they told all of us. That is why Tendulkar is there and we are here. Right? So you look at good leaders, they always focus on strengths. Do the same thing with your children. Focus on strengths. Do that with your team members. Do that across organization. Focus on strength, strength, strength. And you notice, develop supreme confidence in your people with the gift of psychology. Help concentrate on strengths, instead of weaknesses, on powers instead of problems. You don't look at problem. Look at what power I have to solve this problem. So you are a different person altogether. Completely different. So there are four key rules to help leaders develop their people. Rule number one, hold all employees accountable for their local performance metrics. So don't do HR without metrics. No measurement, no HR. Very, very important. Unfortunately, many companies, it still doesn't happen. It may happen partially. It may not happen at every level of work. But it's important how you get the metrics out for every single employee. It doesn't matter what job he's doing at every level. Second, rule number two, teach all employees to identify, deploy, and develop their strengths and the strengths of their direct reports. So focus of the organization must be on strength. Don't focus on weaknesses. Right? Oh, people are poor in time management, so let's do a time management program. No, it's very traditional, old, obsolete way of thinking, including your performance appraisal. Sorry for the sentence if I say, don't get hurt. We say, what is a performance appraisal? We say performance appraisal is a postmortem on a dead body. Why are you doing it and wasting time and energy? Because after every performance appraisal, people are not happy. Only those few who got promoted are happy. Why don't you shift to performance management? Of course, the HR is advanced, but still people are sticking to old ways. It's time to change. Yeah. So rule number three, align all performance management systems around identifying, deploying, and developing strength. So you need to put who is right for what job. We say right person for the right job. It's a very well-known HR cliche. But it doesn't happen in reality. So you put a right person, he's a good guy, but you put him in a wrong role, wrong job, or he's reporting to a wrong person. What does he do? He'll find hell and he'll quit and go. So who lost? Your company lost a good person. And you know from HR, it's not easy to get talent. It's so difficult. When you find a candidate who you want to hold on to him, it's so difficult to get. And rule number four, design and build each role to create world-class performers in the role. So that means you are going to do that one by one. If you can extend these four rules, I'm telling you, you are already setting your HR standards to a different level altogether. So strategic thinking is not just about thinking. It is about thinking, planning, and acting on a daily basis to get your desired results relatively easier, faster, and better. It is to be used on a daily basis in every meeting, with every problem, and in every decision-making process. Your ability to think strategically, not just the routine thinking, happens when you have questions. So, what is your job? What is provoking leadership mindset? How are you going to provoke people? What am I doing now? What am I doing to provoke? Absolutely. So it's all about question. You need not have to have answers for everything. If you don't know operations, if you don't know technology, if you don't know sales, if you don't know finance, doesn't matter, my dear friends, in HR. You know how to ask questions. Enough. You are a king now. Or the queen. Why not? Yeah? So, do you have the right networks to help you see opportunities before competitors do? Right? Are you comfortable challenging your own and others' assumption? Challenge your CEO's assumption in a nice way. You have to be tactful, definitely. Yeah? But do it. Do you learn from mistakes? Can you get a diverse group to buy into a common vision? Right? Do you have probing questions and do you have more questions? So if you don't have questions in your mind, I always tell people, correct? On any program, even today I will say the same thing. If you are going out of this hall today with a lot of questions, I think you are taking the highest value. But if you don't have any questions in your mind after this, I feel very sorry. Because question is going to change you. Not this talk. Right? One of the titles I carry is a change catalyst. Fully knowing as a psychologist that I cannot change anybody. So then what am I going to do? Our job and your job as leaders is to influence people, not to change anybody. Influencing people, how are you going to influence? By giving advice? Who cares for your advice? Honestly, who cares? I always tell people, listen, you don't listen to your own parent advice, right? Your boss's advice. Will you listen to a trainer or a coach or a consultant advice who comes in here for 1 day, 2 day programs like that? You're not going to listen. So why should I advise you? I would rather provoke you with questions so that you become an agent of change, self-change. The moment your self-belief changes, your self-confidence improves, you are a different person. You are a different person altogether. So when Prabhu was sharing outside that, he invited me long back to address his employees, all the workmen. Right? Almost 400 people were there that day. So we took them through health and fitness and those kind of a few things I know about yoga, pranayama. I was just sharing. So you're saying still those people remember, still they do it. Oh, it's so long. I mean, it's just a short little workshop. And imagine a crowd like 400. Okay, if that has stayed there in their mind, if you have stimulated, you provoke somebody to bring about a change, because I'm not in front of them, right? But they are doing it. Oh, it's wonderful. So this is what is the provocation can do. Questions can do. So learn how to ask questions. Don't hesitate. Ask silly questions. Ask stupid questions. But don't hesitate to ask. Because we always think, the fear of asking is, oh, if people laugh at me, if they put me down, right? Because all people look, see, when you look at them, they all look like professors. Of course, we have a professor here, right? They all look like professors and, you know, very senior, highly qualified. What will happen to me, right? So this is where you're going to make a difference, because learn to start asking questions. When you do that, you're very different. There's a wonderful quote from Parker Palmer. Says, a leader is a person who must take special responsibility for what's going on inside of himself or herself, lest the act of leadership creates more harm than good. So leadership is all about what's inside of you, what is going on. Can you take charge of that? More than ever before, today's manager leaders must have a more bigger view of their business to stay alert during the times of constant change and competition. So that is where you talk about a global thinking. So don't think global, act local. You know, those kind of dimensions came there. So how can you reframe your views and thinking to become more strategic and make yourself a better leader? So take ownership, take charge of your dreams. If you're looking at success, these are your dreams, your goals, and your life. If you do not take ownership for achieving your dreams, who will? It's your dream, no? If you don't take charge, who's going to do it for you? So you have to take charge of that. Taking ownership is about change. Make the change to move forward. Change the behaviors that are not working. If it is not working, change it. And deal with the world as it is and not as you want it to be. Making your strategic decision will make all the difference as against routine thinking. It's a strategic thinking. So you look at yourself. So, but one thing, we are almost coming to the end of talk. But very important for us to know, awareness to action. Human success or failure depends on how much of an implementer or doer you are of things that you already know will help you succeed and be happy. They say we suffer from the three I problem, I. First I is the ignorance. I don't know. Post-pandemic era, I don't know what to do. Right? Smoking, I'm a smoker. I don't know how to give up smoking. I'm a very lazy fellow. I don't know how to become energetic or action. Like that, people have different issues. Imagine you come to know, you attend a training program, you attend a talk session like this, or you read a book, you find out that. From ignorance, you move to the next one. Next I is information. But a lot of people are well informed. But nothing. Why? Because the third eye is missing. A lot of people know smoking is bad. They're still smoking. A lot of people know, yes, I should not be, you know, short-tempered. I don't know why I get upset, why I shout at people. But they still do. Then there is no, you know, that is missing. What is missing? The third eye, the implementation. So our biggest challenge is implementation. So that is why they say, again, I come back to Karmanyevadhikara, say, your challenge is not about not knowing. It is about knowing, more than knowing, doing. Whatever little you know, do it now. Right? Srinidhi, I told myself one day, You're telling the whole world how to do yoga, pranayam, meditation, etc., etc. Apart from all this leadership, we always look at the holistic dimension of fitness and health and things like that. I told myself, you every time programs are very good, you know, they all, but why are you not doing meditation every day? That was a question I asked myself many years ago. From that day I started doing. But today I see the benefit. Oh, it's amazing. You're in a totally different world. So it is not about knowing. It is about whatever little you know, do it. Yeah? And that's where the whole dimension is. So you look at that, you're very clear, post-pandemic era, simple 8 steps. Number first step, creating the climate for change, you have 3 steps. If you want to change in the post-pandemic era, number one, create a sense of urgency. Don't postpone. Kal karenge, baad mein karenge, aamele nolana, naale maadana, agala. Right? You have to do it today. Right? So, form a powerful coalition. See, you cannot do it alone. Right? The world is about collaboration. You need people. So, you need to know how to carry people. Then, create a vision for change. First 3 steps. You know exactly your vision, your goal, your aim. And next comes to engaging and enabling the organization. Communicate the vision. So, let people know what you are thinking. And empower action. Enable, you know, let action happen, not only from your side, from across departments, across, and create quick wins, because you want celebrations, you want joy happening. Oh, that happened, this happened. So imagine your organization is going to be full of celebration because lot of small wins are happening in nook and corner. Somebody is cutting a cake, somebody is clapping, somebody is having a party, somebody is having a, get together. Wow, so many things happening. If you can create that, you have provoked, right? And finally, implementing and sustaining change, build on the change and make it stick. So if these 8 steps, if you can carry through, it's amazing. So today, behavioral science of psychology has made rapid advances in enabling your understanding and appreciation of your and your people's true personality types, personality styles and traits. All are different. They are not the same. So people use it interchangeably. They think personality type, style and traits are the same. They are not. They are all different. Type is heredity, genetics. Style is what comes through upbringing influences. Right? You catch the behavior by watching others. Trait is something that situationally you develop. Right? From situation to situation, you know how to deal with your wife and you know how to deal with your boss. Huh? Correct. Now that is how you have developed. That's okay. Right. So then thereby the benefits of psychometric analysis of your people helps you become aware and can make use of it so that you can get the best out of each other by fully making use of each other's strengths and powers to progress despite challenges. Irrespective of what the challenge is, when I'm only looking at your strengths, can you find fault with me? I'm always appreciating you. Can you find fault with me? It doesn't happen. So you need to build strength, strength-based organization, not weakness-based organization. Don't start meetings like saying, you did not do that, you did not do this. How many times I told you, you're always like that, you're a lazy fellow, you never submit your reports. Imagine what mood are you supposed, you know, all what you said may be true. But where is the focus? On weaknesses. Can we shift? Can we make our organizations and teams and departments shift? Psychometrics simply shows if your mind's ways and potential suit each other's strengths, attitudes, expectations, values, beliefs, desires, and wants. See, the belief of psychology is very simple. Strength, strength, strength. Power, power, power. It is never about weakness and problems. It is not that you're not going to address it. You're going to address it. That's why psychologists say, work on your strengths, not on your weaknesses. Work on your powers, not on your problems. So when you do that, with all that, what do? You are doing a gap analysis. Current state, where are we now? This is a reflection thought for you before we go. Where am I now? Do it on yourself. Do it on your team. Do it on your department. Do it across the organization. Where are we now? And desired state, where do we want to go? In between, what do we need to do to get there? How do we do that? What should we do? How do we do that? Now, when you start probing these questions, you are a different person altogether. So Behaviors are created by our thoughts and beliefs as much as by events that surround us. Behaviors can be faced negatively or any behavior. It can be negative, it can be positive. I can run away from because of the COVID problem, I can face it head on, right? I can bring about a change. Then even the most deeply negative behavior can be changed into its positive opposite, and that's the power that you have. Your inner strength assessment and analysis gives you answers by way of right thoughts, which has the potential to help you do the course correction with respect to your leadership and be in control of your life's passion and growth. So if you're passionate about your life, you need to find out what is your passion, where is it coming, what is your inner drive. That's why you keep seeing that, right? Identifying your inner drive and identifying your inner strength. That becomes your mantra, that becomes your solution. The question is, are you ready to act? Your level of readiness for change doesn't happen or develop without you taking charge of your learning and implementation. So time for change, my dear friends. Wonderful, from Simone de Beauvoir. Change your life today. Change your life today. Don't gamble on the future. Act now without delay. Act now without delay. Very powerful words. The right thing you need to do to build your mind is to assess and identify your hidden strengths and unrealized powers within you. You have a lot of power, but you have not realized it. Learn how to leverage your strengths and powers to realize your vision, realize your dreams, and realize your passion. Know how to deal with your weaknesses so that it does not become a threat. You must know your weaknesses, not because you want to improve it, but because you don't want that to become a threat to you. Yeah? So then you can cover yourself. Scientific analysis gives you the opportunity to change, to learn and develop your readiness for greener pastures. Accept your past without regrets, because whatever has happened, you can't change it. Don't keep worrying about it, don't feel guilty about it, because that's a wonderful learning experience, that's why you are better today. Handle your present with confidence and face your future without fear. To revise the past. Why are we doing all this? To revise the past, to revitalize the present. Today you have that in your hand, and to redirect your future. The post-pandemic has come, it has caused a lot of havoc to a lot of people, but when you take charge of yourself, you're very, very different. So very quick, 5 steps. Step number 1, work on your real strengths and powers. I repeat it. Learn to appreciate and leverage the strengths of other people in your interaction. So your job is not only about your strength, also to recognize other people. That means you are developing an eye for other people's strength. That means you are become such a positive, above the line behavior, right? The victor's mindset person. You're only looking at strengths in yourself. You're also looking at what this person has to contribute. How can I leverage, right, on his strengths? And overcome your weaknesses by collaborating with other people's strength and ability. Look at the solution there. I'm weak in something. Should I develop it? Don't waste your time. What I don't know, where I'm weak, he is good at it. So then I should be knowing who can support me. The moment I know you are the right person to support me in that area or that field or that particular aspect of work, I should collaborate with you. Why should I try? In real life, we do that. You're not a cardiologist. If you have a heart problem, you go to a cardiologist. You're not a goldsmith. You want to get some, you know, jewelry done, you go to a goldsmith. You're not a tailor. You go to a tailor to get your clothes stitched. Correct? You know, you're not an electrician. You're not that. Likewise, in real life, you may not be good in writing. Somebody is good in writing. You may not be good in planning. Somebody may be good in planning. Right? So you need to look at what are your strengths, stick to that. What your not strengths are, have the courage to appreciate that person and seek support. I'm telling you, you'll bring a wonderful collaborative world. Mold your inner mind with total focus on strengths and capability. That's it, your focus only on your strength. There is not a single person in this world who doesn't have a weakness. Tell me one person. You can name the biggest names. You mean to say they don't have weakness? Everybody has. So the beauty is, the most successful people don't waste their time on weaknesses. That's all. So if you can learn that one simple thing from them, right, stop finding fault with yourself and also with other people, and start to appreciate, including the pandemic. Because of the pandemic, so many good things have happened. So when you change that mindset, you are definitely a very, 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 very different person. Yes, sir. Any questions? Any thoughts? Sure. Definitely. In fact, I think it's a very valid question, very good question. Thank you very much. You are certainly going to face that problem.
Yes.
What you said is true. I already gave you the solution. Solution is, look at yourself as an influencer. So now that you already have the question, that's the best thing. You have a question, wonderful. Look for answers. Say, okay, how do I motivate people? How do I inspire them? How do I help them do that shift from home working environment to the office back, correct? So there are a whole lot of changes have happened in the entire dynamics. So how am I going to prepare? What am I going to do? How am I going to inspire them? How am I going to motivate them? How am I going to show them the way, right? You can do a FAQ, right? Frequently asked. You can create some 10 questions, answer those 10 questions, or talk to your own team members, talk to some seniors, organizations, or you can always invite well-meaning consultants, including me, most welcome, right? So we can definitely guide you because we have been doing it across organizations. The whole idea is, how do you inspire a better world? How do you reduce the performance gap? Because how quickly can we ramp up, right? Because you don't have time. Performance and productivity cannot suffer because of something else. So that is where your role as people managers, because this is a very important, because human resource is the key that is going to see the post-pandemic era, right? And because of that, you have a very key role, right? I'm sure you can do wonders there, but I'm glad you're already anticipating it. But I would say prepare, but don't forget the power that you have, the power of ability to influence, right? Yes. Any other thoughts? Any other questions? Thank you. You are asking a very deep question. See, not everybody is lucky. Not all of us grow up in environments where we are surrounded by people who influence us, where parents have, discussion with their children. Parents are also well educated. A lot of parents are educated, but they don't talk to children. Correct? They don't know. Nothing happens there, right? You and me may be one of those few ones who are lucky to have those influences, so our mind is kind of, well, the foundation is good. What you can do is, in your own organization, I'm giving you an example from the Japanese. What the Japanese did, they created a lot of, what do you call it as, creative circles. Correct? They said every 10 days, every 1 week, the team decides, those 10 people or 8 people or whatever they meet, right? And for 20, 25 minutes or 30 minutes over a cup of tea, they discuss. One condition, no criticism. In the last 1 week, what did you do? You can only say what good thing you have done, either in your home or in the office or at work, etc., etc., etc. So whole focus is on. So when you say something that you did this, it doesn't matter how. I cannot criticize you. I cannot comment on you. I only clap. So what happened? Whole people clap for you. So now imagine you clap, people clap for you, people clap for him, people clap for him. My turn came, I have nothing to say because I have not done anything in the last 1 week. What happens to me? Next week I will come back with revenge. Absolutely, absolutely. Because I also want to get the applause. See, this appreciation, where I said appreciate, 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 is a wonderful technique. So the moment you Get that going across departments. I'm telling you, it's going to be changing. And I must tell you why this is important is, you have several factories today right now going on strike, lockouts, right? Lot of issues. Why? Because they don't have their mental environment. We talk about glue-like mindset, die-hard habits, concrete wall-like attitudes. Your job is to influence that. Don't forget, you are working against 87% of average performers and poor performers. Who is a poor performer? He's an antisocial element. Right? I would kill you, it doesn't matter, I'll go to the jail. Correct, I'll throw a stone at you, it doesn't matter, you throw a stone at me. He has no value for his own life. Does he care for you? He doesn't. But you are dealing with them, no? Right, and that is what is happening. You look at all the different protests that happen across the country or across the world, it is the same dimension that is happening. Either it happens, a military ruler, Myanmar problem or a Syria problem, you look at anything. But ultimately, common man suffers. So you and me today have the advantage of becoming influencers. You take charge. If today, if my words can influence a few of you here, fine. Why? The ball starts rolling. Because you will go and influence another four people outside. Right? And that is how the entire dimension is. World is like that. Today we have the advantage of internet, we have the social media, we have all this. Right? What advantage did Shankaracharya have or Vivekananda have? Right? Or Ramakrishna have? Buddha have? You know, Buddhism went across, no? Right? What did they have? Nothing. So today, you know, they're all working. That's why, you know, we talk about Carl Gustav Jung, who is the father of psychological types. 1921, he wrote that book, Psychological Types. I am telling you, I know more than Carl, not boasting, but I'm in reality. Why? Because Carl Jung, those days, less aeroplanes, no aeroplane travel was not there, telephone was not there, mobile was not there, internet was, nothing was there. Today, I have all this advantage. I would have done the test at least on about 200,000 people. Right? So I know that definitely more than Carl Jung. Not because Carl Jung is bad. He is the scientist. Credit goes to him. Everything goes to him. But times have changed. So like way, the way you thinking, each one of you are better than the best. You are less than nobody. We all groom like that. The moment your belief is that you are the best, be, do, have, I'm telling you, you become unshakable. I'm telling you, you become the best person. You become the agent of change. Around you, you become the catalyst. You are influencing people. You are energizing people. You are motivating them. You are inspiring them. What are you doing? You are bringing in energy. If you can't bring in energy in your organization, what kind of a leader are you? Forget it. Hello, good morning. Good morning. That fellow doesn't even want to lift the face. Because it's a headache, you know, for him. Why did you wish me? I say, I have to, you know, lift the head so much, no. Energy is not there. So now how are you going, whether you like it or not, such people exist in organizations. It is your job to inspire. You need to bring them out by showing energy, by showing enthusiasm. It's important. It is important that you need to build up your own energy. That's why whenever we do intervention, we always say, come, let's start. Let's understand how do you bring in the mental energy? How do you bring in the physical energy? Right? Because it is not just knowing. Whatever I said, you can also read it in a book, honestly. Right? But inspiration, what a book cannot do, you can do. Influencing people, what a book cannot do, you can do. Right? Because you become like a magnet. You attract. You have that power. Don't underestimate yourself. You are gifted. You are special. You are talented. You have everything in you. And when that mindset in you is provoked, no stopping. I have seen HR people. Many of them are routine administrative people. I have seen HR people. They are number two in the company. Power. Right? Oh, HR means respect. You, they are there, high and mighty. I am sure that, you know, we need to have examples of such HR people who are ruling the roost, because that is where HR belongs. Am I right, sir? We have a lot of veterans here, right? And that is where you are, and that is the potential you have. You need to be, need not have to be afraid of anybody, because every other person, including your CEO, is a human resource. That means you have a big, big stake. Thank you very much. Right? Wonderful listening, and thank you for all the questions. Right? Sure.